That concludes topical questions. And our next item of business is a statement by John Swinney on information sharing provisions in relation to Part 4 and Part 5 of the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement. And I call on John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, improving the lives of all of our children, young people and their families is something that members of this Parliament have been working together to achieve for many years. Getting it right for every child has been the national approach in Scotland to improving outcomes and supporting the well-being of our children and young people since 2006. Its core premise of offering the right help at the right time from the right people was supported by all parties then, and I still believe now. And this government remains wholly committed to applying the Getting It Right for Every Child approach as part of our determination to ensure all of Scotland's children get the best possible start in life. The foundations on which Getting It Right for Every Child is built are the principles of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. Above all, it seeks to ensure that public policy and practice decisions are taken in the best interest of the child and delivers the government's responsibility to protect and support families to nurture their children. The named person service is central to fulfilling the responsibility of government and the wider public sector to enhance and support children's rights. The named person service is a simple but important concept that came from families themselves, that having a single named contact, such as a health visitor or a teacher, that you know you can go to for advice, information and support about any aspect of your child's well-being is helpful for children and parents. And for practitioners, having that same clear point of contact at the core of a team of professionals and services around a child enables agencies and individuals to work more effectively together to better support, safeguard and promote the well-being of children and young people. It makes available access to early support for all families because although it can be clear in some circumstances that help may be required, it is impossible in all cases to predict if or when a family or a child might need extra help. Whether families are faced with difficulties posed by the debilitating cycle of deprivation, an unexpected diagnosis of a disability, a breakdown of family relationships, or other challenges when circumstances change, there are clearly times when children, young people, and their families benefit from a clear point of contact for information and support to help them navigate the system and to get the help that they need. Presiding Officer, as I made clear in my statement to Parliament in September, this government remains absolutely committed to the named person service as a way to support children and their families. On the 28th of July last year, the Supreme Court ruled definitively that the intention of providing a named person for every child to promote and safeguard their well-being was unquestionably legitimate and benign. The judgment itself did not require current policy to change and did not relate to current practice under Getting It Right for Every Child. A local authority or health board can continue to nominate a person to be responsible for the provision of services to a child, and organisations can, within the framework of the existing law, continue to deliver or engage with such existing or developing named person services. I want to reiterate my support for practitioners across Scotland who continue to live up to their commitment to develop and deliver a named person service to families in their local areas within the framework of the existing law. However, the Supreme Court judgment requires us to change the statutory provisions relating to one aspect of the named person service, and that is on information sharing. I believe that the aims of the policy justify broad support, and that when the way forward on implementation of information sharing is accurately understood, it too will command support. The Supreme Court determined that ministers needed to provide greater clarity about the basis on which health visitors, teachers and other professionals who support families will share and receive information in their named person role. It ruled that the information sharing provisions of Part 4 of the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, as they were originally framed, are incompatible with Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights, and that changes are needed to make those provisions compatible with Article 8 to ensure respect for a person's private and family life, his home and his correspondence. The Supreme Court judgment has provided an opportunity, therefore, to revisit the information sharing provisions in the 2014 Act in a way that will not only secure the protection of those rights, but will improve the named person's service and reassure parents and practitioners and the wider public that this service will work with and for families. Since the Supreme Court judgment, I have led a three-month period of intense engagement. I have listened to parents, charities, practitioners, and children and young people, and from those who support the named person policy and those who have concerns about it. Over 3 months, this engagement involved over 50 meetings and some 250 organisations and groups. This included around 700 young people, parents and carers, practitioners, professionals and leaders from education, health, local authorities, police, faith communities, unions and charities. Importantly, we listened to those who had concerns about information sharing and were prepared to consider a revised way forward. We reached out to others, including Care Scotland, Clan Child Law, Together and the Scottish Parent Teacher Council, amongst others. We are grateful to all those who took part in what was a genuinely open engagement. A key part of our engagement was to listen to children and young people. Our commitment to the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child requires us to uphold children's rights by ensuring that their voices are heard, listened to, and acted upon by all those who support them and provide services to help them. On a more personal level, young people recognise the benefit of having access to someone they trusted to help them get support if needed. The government listened to parents. The named person service provides a point of contact and support who works in partnership with parents and families to help them navigate the wider system. Parents told us that they don't always get the support their families need, so they have to tell their stories over and over. Parents also told us they want the named person service to work in partnership with them and that having a say in the sharing of information about their families matters to them. Their views and their experience reinforce the initial rationale for creating the named person service. The government listened to practitioners. As with families, nursing and medical professional organisations and trade unions told us that information sharing that was rooted in consent, engagement and empowerment of families was the best way forward. Only in exceptional circumstances, such as where the risk of harm was present, should we consider departing from those core principles. Practitioners highlighted that professional judgment and discretion remains vital in working with families to decide whether, when and with whom information should be shared. The Care Inspectorate highlighted to us that sharing of relevant and proportionate information in relation to the well-being of children had improved as organisations prepared for the implementation of the named person service. Joint inspections of services for children and young people in 2014-16 showed that most community partnership areas had developed mechanisms for sharing information about individual children with relevant services while working within the requirements of data protection legislation and duties of confidentiality. Therefore, their reports also show that practice, however, remains inconsistent across services in localities and between localities, meaning that families will experience different levels of support. A recurring issue in tragic cases has been a failure to share information when remedial action could have been effective. Putting the findings from this extensive engagement and Care Inspectorate reports alongside the ruling of the Supreme Court makes clear what needs to be remedied. Presiding Officer, we must provide consistency, coherence and confidence in the approach to sharing information below the threshold of risk of significant harm. This is where the named person's role is so important for support to families to get the assistance when they need it. I propose to bring forward a bill that will include new provisions on when and how information can be shared by and with the named person service. The new provisions will ensure that we address the Supreme Court's judgment, live up to our objective of supporting children and young people, and give them and their families reassurance that their rights are fully respected. I intend to introduce the bill ahead of the summer recess, and I will work with Parliament to agree a timetable to enable commencement in 2018. Without legislation, there is a risk that the benefits of a coherent and consistent approach, delivered through good practice in some places, are not made available to all families. This means a longer time frame for commencement than originally anticipated, but I believe, given the significance of the issues involved, Parliament must be given the full and proper opportunity to legislate on these issues. This approach will involve replacing some of the provisions in the 2014 Act that the Supreme Court was concerned about, with new provisions requiring named person service providers and others involved with children and young people to consider whether sharing information would promote, support, or safeguard the well-being of the child or young person, and requiring them to consider whether sharing that information would be compatible with data protection law, human rights, and the law of confidentiality. Only if information can be shared consistently within these legal constraints will there be a power to share it, and the legislation will make this clear. This approach aims to promote good and consistent practice by imposing an explicit duty on named person service providers and others to consider whether or not to share information, whether that would promote, support, or safeguard the well-being of a child, while making clear that this may only be done where there is compatibility with data protection law, the law of confidentiality, and human rights law. Through both practice and the legislative framework, the importance of involving families in the sharing of their personal information will be central to how the named person service works with families. There is also a crucial balance to be struck. We must ensure that the 2014 Act supports children, young people, and families to access support easily if they need this. But we must also strive to ensure that the amendments to the 2014 Act do not result in unnecessary bureaucracy or a burden on services. I have reflected on this point very carefully. To support implementation of this approach, it is proposed that a new section be added to the 2014 Act to provide for the making of guidance specifically on information sharing, designed to address the Supreme Court's judgment. This guidance will be an important resource which will assist practitioners to take a systematic approach to information sharing in appropriate cases. It is envisaged that the guidance could incorporate suitable case studies to assist understanding by practitioners, and it will also help address the concerns expressed in the Supreme Court judgment about the question of proportionality. This approach supports the ambition shared by practitioners for enabling continued improvements in working together while leaving appropriate scope for practitioner judgment and discretion. I would intend that draft guidance will be presented to Parliament as early as possible during the Bill's passage. I am aiming for a draft to be available at the same time as the introduction of the Bill ahead of the summer recess. This Government will also work with practitioners and organisations to enable them to implement the new legislation. We will work with key partners to develop and deliver national training and capability building programmes to ensure that proportionate information sharing that works for and with families is the norm. We will engage key partners in the inspectorates, the statutory, third and independent sectors to develop resources for robust self-evaluation and review mechanisms for use by practitioners. I also recognise that after a campaign that's involved a lot of misinformation about the named person service, it is important for Parliament and the country to have confidence in the getting it right for every child approach. Ensuring the trust of families and young people across Scotland is critical in ensuring the future success of the named person service. The legislative process will create the opportunity to do this. We will also deliver public information campaigns with partners that provide accessible information for children, young people and parents on their rights and entitlements embodied in Getting It Right for Every Child. Presiding Officer, I want to reassure Parliament that we've taken very seriously our responsibility to provide an appropriate response to the Supreme Court judgment. We have sought advice and listened to a wide range of views and experiences. We now intend to put in place measures so that the aims of the named person service, as supported by Parliament and described by the Supreme Court as unquestionably legitimate and benign, is compatible with data protection law, human rights, and the law of confidentiality. By making these changes, we will respond to the Supreme Court ruling in a way that improves the named person service and gives families, practitioners, and the wider public greater confidence that information sharing for named person service purposes will be in line with the founding principles of getting it right for every child and will respect their rights fully. The approach I have set out today seeks to bring consistency, clarity, and coherence to the practice of sharing information about children and young people's well-being across Scotland. but it also seeks to achieve something more fundamental, to enable us to work together as government and parliament to deliver the original aims of a policy journey begun over 10 years ago. Presiding Officer, let us agree today to ensure that we get it right for every child.
Thank you. Then now comes the opportunity to put questions. I would ask any member or invite members to press their request to speak button if they wish to do so. And I call Liz Smith.
Thank you, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for Parasight. Cabinet Secretary, every single opinion poll that has been conducted on the named person policy shows that the majority of the public and a very large number of the practitioners who you mention in your statement do not want named persons. Can I ask on what evidence you have decided not to abolish the whole idea? Secondly, you mentioned that the Supreme Court said that the named person policy intervention was unquestionably legitimate and benign. But to be precise, there is a very significant difference between a policy of caring for well-being with benign intentions and a named person policy which had at its heart potentially disproportionate and intrusive data sharing, which was ruled unlawful. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that key difference, something he's not recognised in his statement? And will he confirm if well-being, in its term, will be defined in the new bill? And thirdly, has the Cabinet Secretary recognised that the most recent statistics tell us that the vacancy rate amongst health visitors, who are obviously key deliverers of the policy, is actually rising, as is the age profile? Is this not a real problem for the implementation of the policy?
Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, on the question of the policy intention, the government was elected on its policy commitments, and the government is committed to the named person service, and Parliament has legislated for that to be the case. And until such time as Parliament legislates not to have a named person service, I'm duty-bound as a minister to respect the view and the wishes of Parliament, and I don't think Parliament would expect anything else of me in that respect. The second point is on the question of the Supreme Court's judgment about named person being unquestionably legitimate and benign. Liz Smith is correct that the Supreme Court raised issues about proportionality. And in my statement, I have gone to great lengths to set out how the question of proportionality will be addressed. And it will be addressed by placing the duty on practitioners to consider whether there is a legitimate case for sharing information, and then going on to consider whether or not the sharing of that information is compatible with the existing legal framework in which we all have to operate. So the question of proportionality is, in my view, as are all issues raised by the Supreme Court, issues that I have no alternative but to address the issues raised by the Supreme Court, and the question of proportionality has been addressed in that fashion. Thirdly, on the question of wellbeing, Liz Smith will be aware that wellbeing is defined in the Children and Young People's Act. The terminology is present in the Act already, and of course Parliament will have to consider the legislation that I bring forward. And on the final point, in relation to health visitors, Liz Smith may not have got to this detail yet, but the data revealed this morning an increase of 117 in the number of health visitors as part of our target of reaching 500 by 2018. And of course, that is welcome progress towards that objective. And we need to ensure that we have a strong health visitor community in Scotland able to contribute to supporting families where they need that support to assure the well-being of young people. And what the Health Secretary and I are very focused on doing is making sure that we have in place a seamless, integrated support arrangement in place for those who need it in our society, to make sure that at the earliest possible opportunity we can act to overcome the difficulties and the challenges that children face in our society, and to provide the support at the earliest possible opportunity we can.
Ian Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and my thanks to the Deputy First Minister for early sight of his statement. The Deputy First Minister talked towards the end of his statement of misinformation about the named person service, and acknowledged, I think, the consequent loss of trust amongst parents and practitioners in the policy. He knows that we have long argued that one of the elements which allows some of these misrepresentations to gain credence is the inclusion of 16 and 17-year-olds in the named person scheme. Can I ask him once again to consider using the legislative process on which he has now embarked to remove 16 and 17-year-olds from the scope of the legislation in order to help re-establish the credibility of the policy?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful to Mr. Gray for his remarks, and obviously I'm familiar with his long expressed view on the question of 16 and 17-year-olds. When I came to Parliament in September, I set out to Mr. Gray the origins of the thinking why 16 and 17-year-olds were included, and the origins of that are the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, which defines a child as a young person up until the age of 18. And the government is trying in a whole variety of different ways, and the Minister for Early Years and Childcare set out information just a few weeks ago on the steps the government is taking in another and different area of policy on the minimum age of criminal responsibility to fulfil our obligations in relation to the UNCRC. So the issue that Mr. Gray raises is not an easy issue for us to resolve against the backdrop of that policy framework. And I also rehearsed to Mr. Gray in September the fact that a sizeable proportion of calls to our helplines, to Childline, from vulnerable young people can be from 16 and 17-year-olds, and I think there is an important and illustrative lesson for us in that. The question of removing 16 and 17-year-olds from the named person legislation does not form part of my current proposals, but obviously Parliament is going to embark on a legislative process, and it will be up to Parliament to consider these questions.
I'm now going to call a number of speakers. The opening speakers get slightly longer questions from now on, very brief questions and equally succinct answers, Minister. James Dornan to be followed by Adam Tompkins.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, I think it might be worthwhile reminding the Parliament and the named person services, the backing of the Parliament, local authorities and the major child welfare organisations. But can the Cabinet Secretary detail how he will consult on the bill and how he ensures to... He will ensure that the Education and Skills Committee will be kept updating any progress.
Cabinet Secretary.
Obviously, I've gone through an intensive programme of discussion and dialogue to get to where I am today, and of course the formal consultation on the bill took place, on the Children and Young People's Bill, and the question of a named person service took place back in 2012. Obviously, the bill will be subject to scrutiny by the Education and Skills Committee, and it will be, the government will of course fully comply with the timetable the committee agrees and that is agreed with the parliamentary authorities to ensure full scrutiny of all of the provisions.
Adam Tompkins to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Will named persons under the Deputy First Minister's amendments be able to share information about children without their consent or without the consent of their parents only where it is necessary in order to safeguard the children's welfare? Because any broader power than that is likely to continue to be in breach of the law.
Cabinet Secretary.
Let me say two things to Mr. Tompkins. The first is that I envisage that information will be shared with consent in all but the exceptional circumstances. And the exceptional circumstances I would consider would be exceptional circumstances provided for by the DPA law, human rights law, and the law of confidentiality. So any exceptional circumstance would have to be enabled for information to be shared without consent, as long as it was provided for in those legislative instruments and within that legislative framework that I've set out.
Rona Mackay to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the many scare stories we've heard in the named person service, a concept which came from families themselves, could the Cabinet Secretary outline how he will ensure that the general public understand how this will work?
Cabinet Secretary.
The first thing to do in that respect is for us to address the issues which have given rise to significant concern. And I think as I've looked through this issue, it's quite clearly the issues around information sharing and perhaps some of the issues that Mr. Tompkins has just raised with me that have caused that concern. And I think the answer the government has come up with today is a very strong and robust answer to those issues which enable us to proceed with an approach that addresses those concerns and then allows us to focus back on the core principle behind the named person service, which is to provide a dependable and reliable point of contact for individuals, for children and families to go to when they require support in our society. And when we strip away all of the debate that's gone on about this, that is what the named person is about. It is about providing a contact point reliably available for families and for children that they can go to when they need help. And in the experience that we've had from the consultation exercise, that is the service that members of the public are looking to achieve. And on that basis, I think we can build public confidence.
Daniel Johnson to be followed by Jenny Gilruth.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The challenges faced by the named person policy to date, I think, are twofold. First of all, the legal issues as identified by the Supreme Court, but also the issues around trust of professionals, teachers, and indeed children. Can I therefore ask what activities within the period of intensive engagement were addressed specifically on that issue of trust? How does the Cabinet Secretary now understand the issues around trust faced by the policy? And what actions will be taken to address these issues of trust and named person before, during and after the implementation of the revised policy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I suppose the formulation that Mr Johnson talks there is helpful. There are legal issues which must be addressed before the service can be implemented in terms of the legislation in the Children and Young People's Act 2014. So we have to address those issues, and I've set out to Parliament the mechanism by which we are going to do that, which is, I might add, the highest level of authority the government can put in place, which is to ask Parliament to legislate on this question. We can ask Parliament to do no greater contribution than that. So that's a first and very important point, that I'm recognising that legislation is required, which in a sense leads me into the second point, which is about building trust. If I'm asking Parliament to legislate again on these key issues, I'm recognising the need to ensure that parliamentary authority is given to these provisions, which I hope will assist in creating some public trust. And then the second point that I would make in that respect is really to link into what Rona Mackay has just raised with me, which is to make the point that when the named person service is explained to people, not as a service that will be intrusive to family life, because as a consequence of the legal issues I am now going to address, we hopefully address that point conclusively. The named person service can be expressed and explained to members of the public as a resource which is of benefit and of assistance as a contact point for families to make sure they can get the support when they feel they need it. And the last point I'd make to Mr. Johnson is about practitioners, and of course practitioners covers a wide variety of different professionals in that respect. And in my experience of the public services, many, many of our public servants, as teachers or as health visitors or as care workers or in whatever function they are exercising, they are very keenly motivated by the well-being of the individuals for whom they are offering support or providing education. And that is, I think, a key connection that enables this policy to be successful, because it links the needs of individuals directly with what can be delivered by public servants. And I think in all of our experience, we all see public servants who make a phenomenal contribution to our society, and we have the opportunity to ensure that members of the public have access to that quality of service.
Jenny Gilruth to be followed by Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I remind members I'm the Parliamentary Liaison Officer to the Cabinet Secretary. To ask the Scottish Government how the sharing provisions within the Children and Young People Act will impact upon classroom teachers.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, obviously, there is a requirement for classroom teachers to be fully cognisant of the role of a named person and what issues can be raised with a named person through the appropriate training and support that is available to them to ensure that that role has been used to the full. But in terms of classroom teachers have a particular role to ensure that they are supporting the young people in their care and working within the structures of our education system to make sure that any concerns that they have about the well-being of young people are properly addressed in the appropriate fashion, whilst respecting the legal rights of individuals in that process.
Ross Greer to be followed by Tavish Scott.
Thank you, and my colleagues would like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for advanced sight of his statement. I'm reassured by Mr Swinney's answer to Daniel Johnson in regards to the government's consultation period over recent months. But ensuring young people in particular are engaged in getting it right for every child is essential. So would the Cabinet Secretary be able to confirm what the Scottish Government will do to ensure that young people, such as through organisations like the Scottish Youth Parliament, which they themselves have directly elected, are engaged in the process, both the legislative process and in the drafting of new guidance?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very keen to make sure that we use this process to build confidence in the whole approach. So therefore, I'll be taking a very open approach to inviting the contributions and the input of organisations to help us to design the legislation, but then also to design the guidance that goes with it. And of course, the guidance that goes with it is very important, because we have to make sure that it provides the necessary clarity for individuals, and therefore having that informed by children and young people would be particularly beneficial. On this question of dialogue with young people, the Cabinet met last week with a group of representatives from the Children's Parliament and the Scottish Youth Parliament for what the First Minister committed us to was an annual discussion on relevant issues of mutual interest. And I know members of the Cabinet got a tremendous amount out of that conversation, and we will continue that dialogue.
Tavish Scott to be followed by Claire Hawkey.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his statement and also for his recognition of the importance of legislation in allowing for the parliamentary scrutiny that I suspect others were hinting at. Does he recognise that the scope of the original legislation was seen to be exceeded by the potential implementation of the named policy proposals, and therefore parental concern is significant and has still to be adequately addressed? Would he recognise, or will indeed the explicit duty that he outlined to Parliament this afternoon guard against the invasion of parental and family privacy that is of such concern? And is he minded to note that that is potentially likely only to be tested, or that balance is likely to be only tested in court? And finally, will he recognise the danger of a breakdown between the police, teachers and health workers on one hand and parents on the other, given the concerns of this matter? And what has he specifically got to do to address to that point?
Cabinet Secretary.
On the last point that Mr Scott raises, my whole intention is to create an atmosphere of partnership working between public authorities and public servants and families. And that is the whole intention behind Named Person, is to make public services much more accessible and readily contactable by individual families. So at the heart of the concept is the encouragement of that process. The second point I would make is that I think anyone looking at my statement will, I hope, come to the conclusion that I have recognised the importance of clarifying the issue of consent around the sharing of information. And my answer to Mr. Tompkins was that information will be shared with consent in all but the exceptional circumstances. And I hope that goes a long way to addressing the issues that I know underpin the question that Mr. Scott has raised with me. And the final point I would make in relation to Mr. Scott's points is that what I have done in my statement is to look very directly at the issues raised by the Supreme Court, and I believe address them directly and adequately. And that is by recognising that if information is to be shared, then there would have to be consideration given of whether the legal authority enabled that to happen. And if that was done, that would protect the rights that Mr. Scott legitimately raises with me today. So the framework that has been put in place is designed to provide that absolute clarity around the sharing of information to protect those very rights that are at the heart of Mr. Scott's question, and which frankly underpin the Supreme Court judgment which I have to address.
Claire Hawkey to be followed by Ross Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline if there will be any additional resources for named person service providers to support the implementation of these changes?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Government has already made resources available for the implementation. We made that allocation to local authorities during 2016-17. Obviously, we'll look at the specific issues that are required in relation to raising awareness on these questions to make sure that practitioners are fully supported in taking forward the important work they have to take in this respect.
Ross Thompson to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I remind members of my register of interest as a serving Aberdeen City Councillor. Is the Cabinet Secretary aware of the survey responses provided by a sample of heads of senior school guidance in 29 Highland Region schools, and which was shared with Bill Alexander, which makes plain the extent of the concern amongst practitioners about the named person policy? 70% strongly agree that named person has caused them greater stress. Over 80% are concerned at the impact of named person legislation, which is 4 in 5 teachers. Further, last year, Aberdeen City Council leader Jenny Lane stated that named person was putting people off taking up positions as primary head teachers in Aberdeen. Therefore, would he agree that with all this evidence, this is naturally a matter of great concern to parents and teachers, particularly when he says today that their trust is crucial to the future of named
Cabinet
person?
Secretary.
I think the point I find difficult to understand in that underpins Mr. Thompson's question is that somehow that members of the teaching profession are not focused on or concerned about the well-being of the children that they educate, because that is what the named person concept is about. That is what the teaching profession are doing every single minute of the day. They are looking at the well-being of children and supporting them to fulfil their potential. So I'm keen that the named person proposal is explained to people in our professions on that basis. And if I heard the explanation of the named person proposal that has been communicated quite extensively in the media, then I think if I was a teacher, I might have some concerns about it. And Mr. Thompson has fueled much of that in the process. So what I'm interested in doing is making sure that we work with practitioners and that we work with parents and families to ensure that we have in place a point of contact that is a reliable asset for families to address the issues in which they might need support from our public services in the years to come.
Monica Lennon to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to pick up on the very legitimate question that Claire Hawkey asked about resources. It wouldn't have escaped the Chamber's attention today that the front page of the Herald states very clearly that over £1 billion has been cut from local government in the past 5 years. So I think that in order to ensure that there are sufficient resources, we do need to get a more fulsome response from the Cabinet Secretary on that point. What could he say, given that we have these cuts in local government, that there will be adequate resources to make sure that this policy does work?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'd point out to Monica Lennon that in the most recent data that was available about local authority spend, there was an increase in resources being allocated to education and children's services. The second point I would make is that the government has already made an allocation to local authorities for the implementation of named person, and that money has been allocated to local authorities in this financial year. Clearly, named person has not been introduced as originally conceived of by the legislation, so local authorities have that money. I haven't reclaimed that money. It's sitting with local authorities, able to support them in their activities. And I come back to the point I made to Liz Smith, that the data that we saw this morning saw an increase of 177 health visitors on well on our way to our commitment to achieve an increase of 500 by 2018. And I would also point out to Monica Lennon, finally, that there has been an increase in the spending power available to local authorities as a consequence of the government's budget decisions and by the decisions that were taken by this Parliament in agreeing the budget provisions.
Stuart McMillan to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his detailed statement. I think interested parties would welcome any information that the Cabinet Secretary could provide on what checks and balances there would actually be on the named person service, and can he offer any assurances on this?
Cabinet Secretary.
There are, of course, provisions within the existing legislation, Presiding Officer, for concerns about the operation of named persons to be raised, a complaints mechanism that exists around the workings of named persons. So there is every opportunity for individuals, if they are concerned about the way in which the service operates, to openly raise those concerns and to have those concerns addressed.
Jeremy Balfour, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary said that he's met with 250 organisations and groups and had 50 meetings over the last 3 months. My understanding is that he's still not met with the No to Name Persons group, who obviously brought this case to the Supreme Court. Can you tell me which organisations he's met with that are against his proposals? And secondly, will he now meet with this group so that they can discuss their concerns with him?
Cabinet Secretary.
I explained my position on this to the Education and Skills Committee when I was there some months ago. I have been focused on addressing the issues that arise out of the Supreme Court judgment to ensure that the named person service can be put into practice. That's what Parliament has legislated for. It's what I consider to be my duty as a minister to make. I know Mr. Balfour doesn't agree with it. I know the Conservatives want it abolished, but that's not the position of Parliament, and I'm a minister accountable to this Parliament. So my democratic duty is to make sure that I address the issues raised by the Supreme Court process. Now, I haven't met No to Name Person because there's a clue in the name. They don't want named person. They don't want to engage a discussion with me about how this could be put into practice. They want to end it. And what I have done is I've discussed with Clan Child Law, for example, who were a party to the legal action, the issues that they're concerned about, to try to adequately address those issues. And obviously, they will speak for themselves and they will make their views clear about the steps that I have taken. But I've engaged with organisations who have expressed concerns, and I relayed them in my statement, Clan Child Law, the Scottish Parent Teacher, the Parent Teacher Council, Together, Care Scotland. These organisations had concerns about named person, and we have engaged with them to try to address those concerns. So I've taken as open an approach as I possibly can do, but I think Parliament will understand that if I'm interested in implementing the named person service and finding a way to do so, it would be unusual for me to meet with people who don't want anything to do with that particular policy to be implemented.
John Mason, to be followed by John Scott.
Thank you. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary will accept that within my constituency there are many vulnerable children and vulnerable families who are really needing a named person and the help and support that they can give. And can he reassure them and me that he will hold firm to his principles in providing this service?
I recognise the need that exists in, yes, in Mr Mason's constituency, but I think that will be the position in every constituency in the country. And there are particular challenges in Mr Mason's constituency, but I can also think of families in my own constituency that would benefit from such a support as well. So I do give them the assurance that I will hold firm on this view. It's why I've come back to Parliament, having taken time to consider the very difficult and complex issues that are involved in this process, to make sure that Parliament can have a legislative consideration at the highest test possible this Parliament can deploy, to ensure that we have in place the measures that can turn into practical support for the people and the families that Mr Mason represents.
And finally, John Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. If the Cabinet Secretary is determined to reintroduce the named persons legislation in this relatively short timescale, will he assure Parliament that the policy intentions of this bill will be fully developed and clearly expressed on the face of this new bill to give Parliament every opportunity to fully debate the policy intentions of this bill and give Parliament every opportunity to make good and ECHR-compliant law on this occasion?
Cabinet Secretary.
The first thing I'd say to Mr Scott is, of course, Parliament has already legislated in the Children and Young People's Act 2014 on many aspects of these provisions. And the only part of it where the Supreme Court expressed any concern was around information sharing provisions. And I've set out to Parliament the route by which I intend to resolve those questions. I have done that to the highest standard Parliament can expect on any question by asking Parliament to legislate again. And obviously, Parliament will have to be satisfied with the timescale that's available to consider that legislation. As Mr. Scott knows, the government does not operate in this Parliament with a majority, so there will have to be agreement about timescales involving committees and other parties to make sure that due and proper consideration is given to this legislation. But, you know, there is often criticism levelled at ministers who take appropriate and adequate time to look at issues. And I have been criticised for taking as long as I have been taking to look at this issue. I make no apology for it, because I want to come to this Parliament with good, strong, well-considered legislation that can address serious issues raised by the Supreme Court to fulfil my commitments as a minister. And Parliament would expect nothing else of me.
Thank you. That concludes our statement. We'll now move on to our debate on International Women's Day. We'll just take a moment to change seats.